Series in Review, Episode 2, Master of Kung Fu, Part 2. Probably wondering why, instead of Solitaire Rose Radio, I said Series in Review. The reason is that the Series in Review is spinning off into its own podcast. So the Master of Kung Fu that I'm doing with Joe is going to be part of this series. The EC is starting up again, and that'll be part of this series. I've got other comic series coming up soon, including Art Ops with artist on the book, Matt Brundage. That'll be coming next week. Series of Reviews not going to be on any sort of schedule. It's going to be when I can get somebody to do it with me, or there are a few that I'm going to do all by myself. Most of the EC I'm going to do by myself, but I don't want to tie myself to a schedule, much like Solitaire Rose Radio. I said last year Solitaire Rose Radio would be bi-weekly, and I realized that that's just not how Solitaire Rose Radio is going to be. Series in Review is going to be the same way. It may be for a while you get one a week, and then it may be gaps between them because it'll depend on if I get an artist or a writer to work with me on them, or if I just do them on my own, or if a series comes out that I really feel strongly about that needs to be done immediately. So what it is, the way I pitch it is this is DVD commentary for comics. So if you have read Master of Kung Fu, if you've read that series, you can follow along. If you've not read it, this will kind of give you an idea of what the series is about. However, there are spoilers because we talk about the stories in detail. We go into the art, we go into the writing, we try to do a little behind-the-scenes stuff if we're able to get that information. So you can look at this as your DVD commentary for different comic series. So this week, it's Master of Kung Fu, the second batch of 10 issues, and then next week is Art Ops. So here we go! All right, we are back with Series in Review. We're going to do the next 10 issues of Master of Kung Fu. With me, I have my co-host from Crazy Comics and Stories, Joe Ryder.
Thank you for letting me in the nice studio again. Wow. I promise I'll clean up after myself this time.
Well, that's good. I'm happy to hear that.
And you know what you'll be happy to hear? I brought my omnibus of Master of Kung Fu. I think I ruined my truck's gas miles bringing it here, but, you know, hey, that's half the fun of Omnibuy.
Well, this is one of the smaller.
Yeah. They're like lethal weapons, too. So where did we leave off last time?
We left off. We did, let me see here which issue this is. Because our next issue is Giant Size number 2.
That was actually one of my faves.
We left off, we did issue 22. And we were starting with Giant Size number 2, which is called The Devil Doctor's Triumph.
Am I right in saying this was the Shang-Chi's first romance?
Yes, this was the first romance. This was also one of the things that I liked about all of the Giant Size issues. Some of the other Giant Size were where things would pay off. The Avengers, it's where Scarlet Witch and Vision got married, or a Kang story would pay off. But these were all self-contained, and they were extra-sized. So it was almost as if these are kind of a precursor to a graphic novel that Marvel would do, because they were usually 50 or 60 pages. And this one was all done by Paul Galassi, inked by Jack Abel.
And of course, the interesting thing is the last time we left our party, they had just won a symbolic victory and kept Fu Manchu from blowing up Mount Rushmore. And then all of a sudden he shows up and they're in New York. At least I think it was New York.
Yes,
it could be Miami. I forget. They jumped around a lot.
It's back in New York.
Now, did these issues, when they came out, were they, I mean, we're reading them in sequence according to how the omnibus is, But did they come out in this sequence? Would you have been like, okay, I just picked up Master of Kung Fu number 22. Now giant sizes on the shelf.
Usually.
Were they just kind of specials and like, if you'd never read giant size, it wouldn't have bothered you one way or another because you just would have picked up number 23.
Well, the giant size were quarterly. And they don't lead one into another. So the giant size would come out and you could read it independent of the regular series. And as you read this one, it was completely self-contained. It starts with Shang-Chi meeting a woman. And let's see. I want to grab her name here.
Sandy.
Sandy.
I don't know if they ever gave a last name, but I did catch that was their first name.
Nope, they did not give a last name. And the opening sequence is, it shows her being very wise and owning this kung fu studio, and she's running the entire conversation while Shang-Chi is just listening and being dragged along. On this.
He was, and you really, I mean, you think, what a sap, but he's also, this is kind of like, I said, it's his first romance. I mean, he's obviously led a sequestered life up until he broke away from Fu Manchu. So, you know, this, why not? It's New York. He's out on the town. He's a virgin. I think he's a virgin. I suppose, let's see, comic code. Yep, he's got the comic code. He must be. So why not? Yeah, let's just have some fun.
And one of the things that this pointed out to me as I read it, and moreover, as I read the 10 issues that we're going to cover, in most stories, the hero is the one who drives the story. He's the one who, his actions set things in motion. And in this story particularly, Shang-Chi is passive. He is dragged along by events around him. He is not the one driving this story. He, of course, is has vowed to take out Fu Manchu. But in this, as you read the story, he's being manipulated, first by Sandy, then by Dr. Smith. And he's not the one driving things. He is being put into situations by other people, which, especially for a comic book hero, is an odd style of storytelling. And it really comes out in this story where things happen, and he is pulled along by them. And, of course, on the date, he is attacked by Fu Manchu's people.
I'm shocked. As a sidebar, if you can take the dates right, I'm going from Atomic Avenue to the Overstreet Buyer's Guide. Issue 21 came out in October. 22 came out November, and this is 1974. The giant size we're talking about came out in December of that year, as well as number 23. Now, again, at this time, there weren't the comic shops that we know and love. They were starting to exist. They were definitely some around in the 70s like that. So whether or not you got this in order or you just ran into it later as a happenstance, I don't know. Maybe somebody from the 70s can call us and let us know if they remember how they got these. But they definitely referred to other things. There was a panel there, one of them, where he's talking about the first time he clashed with Blackjack, as seen in Master of Kung Fu number 17. So they are trying to, if you're picking up this issue, they're trying to get you into the other ones. But as Corey said, it is a standalone. So, again, why a giant size versus an annual?
They weren't doing annuals because the giant size were coming out quarterly. And one of the things Marvel was doing, they were actually eyeing doing giant size for regular series. If you remember, the first New X-Men was giant size number one. And then the regular comic, 93 and 94? Or is it 94 and 95? 93 and 94 were the first two.
Yep.
That was actually giant size number two, but they drew some pages, so it would be two comics. Same for the Invaders. Same for Supervillain Team-Up. Marvel was actually looking at doing giant size series, much like they had the magazines. They were trying a bunch of different formats because comic sales were dropping, and they were trying to find new formats that people would buy.
And in 96, and that'll be probably in Volume 2, they did actually do an annual.
Yes.
So, but we're jumping ahead, as we're wont to do.
And another thing about Marvel at the time, you have to remember, we're on the 10th story published about Master of Kung Fu. This is the second issue of the Giant Size. They also had a black and white magazine. This character just kind of exploded in popularity. Much like with Conan, much like with other things at the time, it's, oh, we got a hit, we're going to put out more books. Another thing about this story is...
Shang-Chi, nice kiss. Wow. Right in Central Park. And, of course, after his first kiss, there's a fight. So,
but the page of his first kiss, this is Paul Galassi showing what he can do and taking ideas from Jim Sternanko. If you notice, the top of the page, you've got his eyes and her eyes. You've got mirroring panels across the top. His face on one side, her face on the other side. His mouth on one side, her mouth on the other side.
And then before you get too excited, this is a code-approved book. His hands do stay above the waistline.
And also, then, the row of panels beneath is actually one. It's one picture broken up into four panels to show the dialogue.
No, wait, this is 70s.
One story.
60s, you can't
use. I mean, it's one picture divided into four panels. And then later on, there are also other instances of him doing this. There's the duality of showing Fu Manchu and Shang-Chi in varying panels across a tier of panels. This is Galassi using the art to give the story more depth, to give the story almost a cinematic feel. So that we're not spending an whole hour and a half on just this one story, we then lead to a confrontation with Fu Manchu where he fights the Saifan assassins.
Yeah, but just remember, you know, there was a big-ass fight on the airplane. I'm telling you, if TSA was around, that fight never would have happened. We do not let, what do they call, what does Fu Manchu call his geeks?
The Saifan.
Yeah, we don't let Saifans through security. Sorry, that's just, they're a prohibited item.
And so, the other thing, when they do land, Shang-Chi talks about he was given a gift that profanes giving. And you don't see what it is till later in the story, where it's a pair of nunchucks. Shang-Chi doesn't like weapons. He'll use weapons later on, and he uses them in the story, but he sees them as dirty. He sees them as something he would rather not use. You're getting that philosophy more and more with the dialogue. And it's very much kind of a standard story where he is invading Fu Manchu's stronghold. He fights the Saifan assassins, and then he must go through a bunch of death traps. Which, you know, again, it's very much like Game of Death, the Bruce Lee movie. It's a standard martial arts trope. But I want you to go to, Joe, could you turn to page 288?
Yeah, ooh.
We get the page where Shang-Chi is going through the maze to fight the people in the maze. The page is drawn like a maze, with the dialogue and each fight as you follow along to see the path. More of Galassi being innovative, doing things that you can do in comics that you can't do anywhere else. This is also another story where Shang-Chi is hallucinating. The miasma has been given to him so that he can't trust what he sees. And because of that, he believes he has killed this girl that he was with, thinking it was death. He was hallucinating. We find out that he had actually killed her. Yet another death to lay at the feet of Fu Manchu. But also Fu Manchu starts hinting that the things that Shang-Chi believes happened in the origin story may not be true. The big twist is the scientist that he came there to save, who was killed. Fu Manchu thought that he was holding secrets, that he was hiding a doomsday weapon, and what it was, the scientist had spent his time trying to figure out a way to feed the world, which enrages Fu Manchu. He was supposed to be working on Fu Manchu's death traps and such. So we also find out at the end that this woman was part of Nayland Smith's group of spies. She was to seduce Shang-Chi to get him involved to bring him to this stronghold. So once again, Nayland Smith has manipulated Shang-Chi into doing what he wants in the battle with Fu Manchu. We started with Fu Manchu manipulating Shang-Chi. Now Nayland Smith is doing the same thing.
So there is one thing, I talked about that the last time we looked at a giant size. They kept saying, Nexus Chew, the Yellow Claw. Well, there was in the annual, apparently a backup story. It reprinted the second story from Yellow Claw number one. Has nothing to do with Shang-Chi, but that's what they're referring to. So,
well,
you'll see the reprints in the actual issue, you don't see them in the omnibus.
Right. And they were reprinting it to try and get the people acclimated to, this is who the Yellow Claw is. Because he had been used in Sternenko's shield.
The interesting thing about it is that they made Jimmy Woo an agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. rather than the FBI like he appeared in the original issues.
Right.
They were trying to update it that.
So, again, they promise that Shang-Chi will face the Yellow Claw in the next giant size. The next issue is issue 23, River of Death, written by Mention, drawn by Al Milgrom, and a very young Claus Janssen. Janssen inks, Al Milgrom pencils. Galassi probably was still working on the giant size because it was it's twice as long as a regular comic. This one is a little convoluted. Fu Manchu has started doing something in the jungles of South Africa.
I'm trying to figure out where did they end up, because it was like they were on a boat, and next thing you know, they're in the jungle. Welcome to the jungle! And, of course, we have to run into, just the most racist character ever. You know, I forget what the name of the dude is, but he's like, who is this yellow guy? I don't want this yellow sun stealth and, oh my lord. This is the 70s, folks. We have to.
And you also need to remember, this is part of the plot. He was a soldier who had been captured and tortured by the Japanese, so he hates all Asians. There's a twist later, but they're on a boat going down the river to Fu Manchu's hideout. Shang-Chi is not allowed on the boat, so he follows along through the jungle. And we find out that William Booker was perhaps the most loyal officer in the entire Third Reich.
Oh, again with the Nazis.
Well, in the 70s, a lot of people don't remember this, but in the 70s, if you were writing a novel, the Nazis were going to be your bad guys. To the point where I remember mid-70s, late-70s, you'd go to the action and mystery section of the bookstore, everything would have a swastika on it. They were always fighting Nazis. You watch movies, Boys from Brazil, The Marathon Man. Nazis were the perfect bad guy.
In a twist that made Leonard Nimoy's character on Mission Impossible, Paris, just thrilled, he pulls off a mask to reveal his false face, to reveal scars which spoil more than flesh, which reveal a separate identity, which is, comic book Hollywood tripe. I suppose now things like that, special effects would work, but I mean, these guys are just pulling off like plastic masks to hide their face, Although I don't know if the big reveal is that terrifying. I mean, it would have been, I don't know, maybe it's to throw you off, because if you'd have seen his face, say they drew him that way from the beginning, you wouldn't be thinking, oh, he's a sturdy white blonde hero, you know, barrel chested, big muscles, never mind the fact that he doesn't like the yellow man. So to see he's actually a disfigured Nazi was probably more of a shock than finding out that Fu Manchu was never on the boat to begin with. Because I think that was one of the reasons Shang-Chi thought that he couldn't be on the boat. He thought maybe he's there.
Another thing is, this is another case where you're dealing with ethical issues. You're teaming up with the Nazi to fight Fu Manchu. Which is the greater evil?
And so being that Fu Manchu was already one step ahead of both these parties, I would think Fu Manchu might win that one.
Well, it's more to put the character in a place where his ethics are going to be challenged. And one of the things I like about the series, and I like about what Mensch did, is this doesn't just happen and then in a vacuum. We're getting Shang-Chi, who narrates the stories, talking more and more about, is what I'm doing right? Am I doing the right thing? The character is dealing with shades of gray rather than just good and evil, which makes it more interesting. You've also got kind of a triangulation. Nayland Smith willing to compromise no matter what, as long as it's to get at Shang-Chi. I mean, to get at Fu Manchu. Whereas, you know, is that the right thing to do? And we as readers were kind of dragged along in this. So it's, the issue ends with, it looks like Shang-Chi has been shot, falling into the water. And another thing that, for the second part, you've got four pencilers on this thing. It's Doug Mensch, Al Milgram, Jim Starlin, Alan Weiss, and Walt Simonson.
Yep.
And in a later letters page, they talk about, yeah, the deadlines were terrible. We had to bring in the crew to finish it up. And Milgram and Starlin, I think, were roommates at the time. Alan Weiss was involved in that, too, and Simonson. So I imagine it was one of those where they were sitting around the apartment, just everybody drawing to get it done as fast as they could. With the cliffhanger from last issue, Shang-Chi's been shot, and he's fallen off the boat into the water. Nope, he's fine.
Yeah, no acknowledgement that he took a bullet in his shoulder.
And,
You know, swamp water can do that. Look what it did for the man thing.
And in this, we continue our journey to battle Fu Manchu in the heart of the South American jungle. We discovered the Nazis have something down there, too. And it's become a three-way battle. Well, it's become a battle between them with Shang-Chi and Nayland Smith and Blackjack Tar in the middle. In a lot of ways,
such sensitive word balloons from that Nazi. Hold it right there, chink. Oh, that one's almost painful. But it fits for the Nazis.
It fits for the Nazis. This felt much more like just a straight action story rather than anything really, really groundbreaking. It was okay. It wasn't great. But, Joe, I'd like you to look at the letters page.
Okay.
There is a single, well, no, there are two letters, and the first one is a long letter about what's going on in the book, the deeper thoughts and processes of it, and it's by Peter B. Gillis, who went on to write for First Comics and Marvel, and is the co-creator of Strike Force Moratori. So the book is getting people who are writing more thoughtful letters, longer letters. And I talked about the last episode. Don McGregor said that the word around the office was, if you're getting a lot of typewritten letters, your book is going to get canceled because it's not selling to kids, it's selling to older readers. So you've got that. I always find it interesting when you see a comic professional who has a letter in the letters pages who, you know, a few years later, oh, yeah, he's actually working in comics. The next issue, issue 25, has one of the worst covers I've seen on a Master of Kung Fu book. It's just very poorly staged.
He's fighting Conan clones.
He's fighting Conan clones, but look at his body. His body is just twisted and not, it doesn't look realistic.
He looks like he's in action in a Flintstones still or something.
Yes. And one of the things about some of the better artists on this run is they actually knew their martial arts and would draw characters in martial arts poses. This one, I can't really tell who did it. It kind of looks like Buscema.
On the cover?
Yeah, it looks like a Buscema drawing with some Gil Kane influence.
Ron Wilson and Joe Sinnott.
Okay. Yeah, not a good cover at all. And then you turn the page, and Paul Gallese's back, and, oh, that's a beautiful page right there. But also, if you notice, take a look at Blackjack Tar.
He's thinned down a bit.
He's been completely redesigned. He's completely redesigned as a character, because in his first appearances, he was almost 7 foot tall and almost monstrous and bald, and now he looks more kind of like I remember him later on, where he's just kind of a big, burly British guy.
Oh, by the way, Shang-Chi took a knife to the shoulder previous issue, and he apparently healed super fast. So
yeah.
He's 2 for 2. Same shoulder, by the way. I should mention, just as a collector thing, all these issues we're talking about right now have those value stamps in them. So if you are looking to get a near-mint copy or so, you probably want to double-check to make sure that they do have it. The value stamps showed up at about issue 21. They disappeared after this issue, thank goodness. Mint issues vary anywhere from like $10 to $15, so you know they're not terribly expensive, but it is something to keep in mind if you are trying to if you're not an omnibus man, you just want the original in near mint shape.
Another thing about this issue, Galassi's back with Sal Trapani doing the inking. Sal was kind of one of those journeyman inkers. He showed up everywhere. I really liked his inks on this issue. I think he really complements Galassi's art very, very well. In this story, again, this is like one of the things, one of the tropes that they thankfully Mensch points it out. Shang-Chi just kind of wanders off. Nayland Smith and Blackjack Tar are getting ready to leave the jungle and go back. Shang-Chi hears a sound in the woods, just wanders off. And we don't check in with them again till the end. So in a lot of ways, this was very much a kind of a self-contained story. And what it is, a child has been left in the woods to be killed by, what is that?
It's leopard. It's a very yellow leopard.
Yes. So Shang-Chi saves the child, beats up the leopard, brings it back to, is then confronted by South American warriors. He can't communicate with them. They can't communicate with him. He is brought back to their village after, you know, kind of defeating them in combat. And there is a Saifan assassin who's been captured by them, who's going to be kind of our interpreter. He's the guide for this story. He's tied to a post. And he understands their language, so he lets them know that this child was born on a moonless night, and it was left out to die because the child is considered evil. Shang-Chi cannot allow this, so he goes through a number of trials to save the child's life. He walks on coals without flinching. He runs through where he's beaten on by these warriors. He fights the warriors, and eventually he earns their respect, of course, and saves the life of the child. But Marvel isn't doing the two-page spreads anymore, because there for a while they were doing these two-page spreads, and you would think, oh, they're doing two-page spreads because they were cool. No, it was, we need 17 pages, we're only going to pay you for 16, so take one of your pages, turn it sideways, and draw it for two pages. But, Joe, I want you to go to page 350.
All right. That's almost a splash page.
yes, this is a one-page thing, and it's very much an homage to a Sternenko page where Captain America is fighting Hydra agents, and he's on top of them fighting. This is very much an homage to that, except Galassi's staged it a little differently. But it still kind of has that power, and it shows that Galassi is improving as an artist with every issue. This whole issue, I thought, was just beautifully drawn. And then we get to the end, and one of the things that Shang-Chi has asked, that the Saifan assassin be released, and the Saifan assassin says, so, then tell them, just as I have freed the child from death, I wish you to be freed as well. And we go back to Shang-Chi saying, would you seek my father? That's one of the motifs that has come back. Would you seek my father? Or people asking him, would you seek Fu Manchu? And the Saifan assassin, I am grateful that you have saved my life, but Fu Manchu still wishes your death. We don't get a big fight scene. It's pulled way back. They're on the side of a cliff, and we see the Saifan assassin thrown off the cliff. Shang-Chi returns to Smith.
Oh, no, no, he might have fallen. He could have tripped. We don't know. We didn't see it.
Yeah.
More importantly, I got to know where Nayland Smith is getting these wonderful planes, because when they landed here, they were in a jet, and now they're in a turboprop.
We find out that later that he's still working for Scotland Yard and MI6.
Yeah, but what did he do with the jet? Just leave it?
Somebody else took it back.
It's not like it crashed or something. I mean, come on.
It's probably the artist. Well, Galassi did work on that story.
You know, he likes to draw props. I don't know. Give him props.
Galassi did not work on that story. So.
Well, he's a penciler on it.
No. On the first part of the story.
Oh, okay. Well, okay. He's off.
Al Milgram drew the first part of the story.
Damn it, Al. This is why we need no prizes, people.
Now, Joe, what did you think of this story? This was my favorite story of the ones that I've read.
I liked it just because of it was like an outstanding long issue fight. And I thought it was done well. The art was good. The idea you talked about where he can't communicate with these people, although he did kind of get into the one guy who was kind of his Greek chorus. You know, for whatever reason, Shang-Chi thinks he's doing well, doing right. But, you know, from the members of the tribe he runs across, he's not. And it was a good fight issue. I mean, the action flowed pretty good. It'd be interesting to talk to Paul. You know, how did you stage these fights? I mean, I've known guys who they'll use figures and just kind of, okay, move this way, move that way. Or you tell me, Corey, is Paul an aficionado of Kung Fu cinema?
I imagine at the time, because Kung Fu cinema was so influential to this, and many of his drawings of Shang-Chi look like Bruce Lee, later on in Galassi's career, he used a lot of photo reference, sometimes to the point where it made his art not look as good. One of the series that he mentioned in the 80s for Epic, called Six from Sirius, he used so much photo reference that, to me, his figures looked stiff and the storytelling wasn't very well done. But here, he's learning his craft. He's using photo reference in the way that I, as a non-artist, think it should be used, for posing and shadow, to see how do shadows fall on a person. How are poses done? How are these things done? And I really appreciate the fact that he's putting so much thought into it, especially with Mensch. Again, you talk about how what is good, what is evil, what is right, what is wrong. This isn't a comic that's dealing with, you know, who do I punch in the face? This is dealing with complex questions of good and evil for a 70s comic. And a lot of the things that I enjoyed about 70s Marvel was the writers struggled with that. They wanted to bring in more adult ideas. Stan took one-dimensional stories and made them two-dimensional by giving the characters unique personalities. And then in the 70s, you had
a younger crop of writers who wanted to take that a step further. They wanted to have stories with some ambiguity. They wanted to have some stories with more social meaning, kind of bringing stuff more. I'm not going to say that these are adult stories, because still, you know, I read them when I was 13, 14 years old and got a lot of enjoyment out of them. But there's stuff in here that if you're over 14, you're still going to enjoy this story.
What I do like at the letters page, there's a couple of things I'll point out. First of all, the ad for the Strange Tales featuring Warlock. This is the beginning of Jim Starlin's run of Warlock. And, of course, I mention it because, you know, I've blown a couple out on eBay. A lot of key appearances in that. If you can find them in mint shape, they run close to $200. And I also like the previous page where it has the Be a Mighty Marvel Salesperson, or maybe just a Thrifty True Believer. And, of course, you look at the list of the titles that they're publishing. Group 1, Daredevil, Hulk, Kid Colt, Spider-Man, Dracula, Captain America, Frankenstein / Worlds Unknown, Marvel Superheroes, War is Hell, Marvel Spectacular, Marvel Tales, the reprints we so loved, Marvel Greatest Action, Weird Wonder Tales, Triple Action, Monsters on the Prowl, Where Monsters Dwell, which I believe those are reprints, Two-Gun Kid, Group 2, Avengers, Thor, Man-Thing, Conan, Marvel Team-Up, Werewolf by Night, Fantastic Four, Daredevils, there's our good one, Master of Kung Fu, Jungle Action, Power Man, Marvel 2-in-1, Ghost Rider, Kazar, Astonishing Tales, kind of a list right there of just what Marvel was publishing at the time. And, of course, the aforementioned Strange Tales, starting up with its original numbering at 178. I find that stuff just fascinating, just an idea back then. I mean, this is why, as a kid, I could pretty much be a Marvel zombie. I could pick up all these. I mean, I didn't pick up the reprints because I kind of figured they were reprints. You know, you just can't do that nowadays. There's just way, way too much. And, of course, no variant covers. Woohoo!
Now, the next issue we get to is Giant Size number 3, Giant Size Master Kung Fu number 3. Paul Galassi, and it's written by Mensch. Mensch writes every issue that we're going to be covering for quite a while. He's the only writer on the series for a long while. Drawn by Galassi, but it's inked by Vince Colletta.
Yeah, but look, it says Doug Thought, Paul Vision, Vinny Strength, and Tom is Symbols, Bill is Hughes, and Len Wein is Control.
Yep, colors so by right Bill there. Mantlow.
Yep.
He got in the door by doing colors and proofreading. So this is very early in his career, too.
He's back in New York, I believe.
Yes, he's back in New York.
His book gets around.
This is a story that introduced the character of Clive Reston. Clive Reston, who, as you read the story, his great uncle, they don't come out and say that it's Sherlock Holmes, because Sherlock Holmes was still copyrighted at this time, but he pretty much says his great uncle is Sherlock Holmes, and his father is James Bond. Again, he doesn't say it's James Bond. He says, well, you know, it's the most deadly agent in Her Majesty's Secret Service.
Is this an original character, or is this from another...
This is an original character. It is not from any of the Sax Rohmer books.
Has he appeared anywhere else?
I don't think Marvel has used him outside of the Master of Kung Fu.
Yeah, he's Master of Kung Fu 34 and 39, and they list him in the handbook. But, there's a character they could be using.
Well, I don't know, because they've just brought back Shang-Chi, and they use him in places, but they don't seem to be using any of the supporting characters, including characters who were created for the series that are used later. But Clive Reston is, again, this is another time where Shang-Chi, he's attacked by someone who works for Fu Manchu trying to kill him. And then he's brought into Clive Reston's home. And he doesn't drive the story. Clive Reston drags him along through it.
With a ki-yi-yi as they burst through the windows.
And it's another story where they go to one of Fu Manchu's strongholds. And there's a fight. But one of the things about it is, I wanted to get to the end. We find out that Dr. Petrie is alive, that the person that Shang-Chi killed in the origin story was not really Dr. Petrie. It was a doppelganger created by Fu Manchu, and Fu Manchu has been holding him here, torturing him and trying to get information out of him. And this leads to a long conversation at the end between Nayland Smith and Shang-Chi about what they are doing. We also find out that Nayland Smith, one of the reasons Fu Manchu has been after him, is Nayland Smith stole a statue that had the elixir Vietai in it, which is the elixir that Fu Manchu uses to stay alive as long as he has.
Wow, Fu Manchu looks terrible.
This whole issue looks bad.
And why is that?
Vince Coletta's inking. I've talked on other podcasts about how Vince Coletta had decided he does so much time per page. I get paid this much to ink, so I'm only going to put forth this much effort. And on an artist who uses a lot of light and shadow, like Galassi, it really shows. There are certain pages in here that look like he spent maybe 10, 15 minutes. The shadows are gone. The way to use a light source to heighten the drama is gone. It's all very flat. And there are some pages where it's very clear that Coletta was inking and went, there's eyes, there's a mouth, fuck it, I'm done. And go on to the next page. And there's such an amazing loss of detail from the previous issue that it's not Galassi. And when I was a kid, if I would have picked this up, I would have said, wow, this Paul Galassi's not really a good artist. On page 382, he does the bit where you get the duality. One character's talking, the next character's talking, and the panels go back and forth between the characters, showing the dichotomy between the two. But the actual art itself is just, it doesn't look good. It's laid out well, but it doesn't look good. And Coletta just, you could tell that there's not a lot of caring in it. And there are also a lot of pages where the characters are turned away. You don't see their faces. And I wonder if that was a stylistic choice by Galassi, or because he knew it was being inked by Coletta, it's like, he's not going to put any detail into that. So let's figure out a way around this. The story I thought was good, even though it's very much kind of a rehash of the last giant size, which is, okay, Fu Manchu captures him. We get a revelation as Shang-Chi has defeated all of his death traps. This was also supposed to be the fight with the Yellow Claw, and it didn't happen. And I have yet to find any interview as to why it didn't happen.
Yeah, I think they actually had three Yellow Claw stories. So if you're reading this thinking,
yes,
you know, this isn't as heavy as some of the other giant-sized stories. I mean, it's the same amount of pages, but they actually had three little reprints of, I don't know, when did that Yellow Claw come out?
Came out in the 50s.
Okay.
And the Yellow Claw stories are available in one of my favorite Marvel masterworks. It has all of the issues of Black Knight, which were drawn by Joe Manili, and all of the stories of the Yellow Claw, which were drawn by Al Feldstein of EC fame, after EC had folded. And then when he went back to edit Mad, Jack Kirby drew some issues.
Interesting.
Now, the stories are very 50s racist.
Yeah. Well, and like I said, for Jimmy Woo, he's an agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. now instead of FBI.
And one of the reasons they did stuff like that is each magazine, each comic had a budget. And the books that they didn't think would sell as well would have backup stories, like Jungle Action always had reprints in the back. And one of the things that Don McGregor hated was he was doing these Black Panther stories, and in the back they'd reprint 50s Atlas Jungle stories, which were unbelievably racist. So he would take time for free to to put in extra things like he's going to draw a map of Wakanda, or he's going to do this, he's going to do that. Or he would pay the artist out of his own pocket for a pinup and put it in there. In the black and white magazines, they would have so many news stories and so many reprints. In the giant sizes, after the first couple, they weren't selling as well. So, okay, we could afford this many new pages, and then the rest will be reprints. So kind of the financials, much like how, okay, we're going to pay you for 17 pages for an 18-page comic. Marvel was very conscious of making sure that they met their budgets, even though they were losing tons of money because the books were being delivered to the printer late. The next issue is issue 26, written by Doug Minch, drawn by Keith Pollard, inked by Sal Trapani, who inked previous issues. Keith Pollard, who's also done some issues in the past. This is the issue that starts a new story. It's a three-parter?
I think so.
It's a three-parter. Yeah. Yes, it's a three-parter, but they're not continued. This is one story. This is another story that follows it up, and this is another story that follows it up. And this reintroduces Fu Manchu's daughter,
Fa Lo Sui,
who in the first movies was in the first Fu Manchu movies when Boris Karloff was playing Fu Manchu. And she is the prototypical Oriental dragon woman.
She is hypnotically seductive. Her voice and movements command attention. Her eyes can entrance a man in moments. She has easily manipulated a variety of men into falling in love with her, devoted to serving her wishes. And she occasionally uses scented vapors, her hypnotic rubies, to further enchant her skills. Sort of like how I met my wife.
But this is very much...
And she's as devious as a cunning as her father.
Right. But this is... One of the things that we've talked about is the racist past of the sex roamer characters. This is where the Oriental dragon lady who can hypnotize white men... This is where that stereotype comes from. And one of the things Mensch does is he tries to make it less of... It's because she's this mysterious Oriental woman to where, nope, she has learned these things from her father, and some of it's almost kind of like a mutant power. They don't really say that she has superpowers, but they kind of hint that she's not a normal person. She's also been using the elixir of Fu Manchu, so she has been alive for a long time as well. The plot of this is very much different from previous ones to me in that we're getting a shift in the type of story. In this, she has a plan. She's out to get these rubies that have magic powers. Nayland Smith is trying to stop them. And we also find out that she has decided she has started a war with Fu Manchu. So once again, the plot of the story is triangulation. Fu Manchu versus Nayland Smith versus Fa Lu Sui versus Fu Manchu. You've got that triangulation with Shang-Chi caught in the middle. And this is very much the caper story. How is she going to steal these rubies from the Golden Beetle? Are they going to be able to stop her? Keith Pollard draws her very... seductively, very... He doesn't emphasize the Oriental features as other artists did. Matter of fact, she just kind of looks kind of like the generic Marvel evil villain in a lot of ways. And at the end of the story, we find out that she has stolen the rubies, and Fu Manchu destroys the place where the rubies were kept. We also see that Smith has in the past been mesmerized by her, and she can do it again.
What a lucky guy.
Now, for me, this was very much, it felt like a spy story. Very much, Whereas in the past, it was very much, okay, you're going through the motions. This, it seemed a little more like chess, where different characters are doing different things and manipulating each other. Joe, what did you think of this issue?
We've been waiting. How many issues now? We're at issue 26. We've been waiting this for the final confrontation between Shang-Chi and Fu Manchu, and it happens in Fu Manchu's laboratory. And it's basically a big discussion between the two, kind of almost an airing out. And
it's not in this issue, Joe.
Are you sure? Did I jump ahead?
Yep, you jumped ahead.
Oh, I did?
Yes.
Well, then skip that out. We won't talk about that. I'm like way ahead, just like, holy shit.
Yes, you have jumped way
ahead.
Okay,
forget that. Just edit that out. This was one of those issues where, you know, to me, introducing a new character, I wasn't aware of her history that, you know, she's actually part of the licensed group. So it was kind of an interesting setup. And it also brings in another front because she's not, like you said, is she for Shang-Chi? Is she on her own? You know, at first she's against Fu Manchu, but she's got her own agenda. So it kind of, it brings, I'm trying to think how you'd say it, it brings another interesting angle in which to view this. I mean, were there flashbacks of...
No, the flashbacks are in a later issue.
So, yeah, I mean, this is kind of like we're learning. He obviously, Shang-Chi knows who this is, but we don't.
Well, there is a flashback. It's a short one. There are longer ones in later issues, but we do get a one-page kind of telling you these two had a different relationship as when Shang-Chi was a child.
Yeah, I'm just looking for it. But
and she's
it's a setup.
Basically hinting that Fu Manchu is not as he appears. So in a lot of ways, they're doing kind of a retcon to one of the issues you had with the origin. And in some ways, they're almost undoing that origin issue. Oh, Dr. Petrie's alive. Oh, the seeds of doubt were already planted in Shang-Chi, that Fu Manchu may not be the celestial one, the great father that Shang-Chi thinks. Mench is kind of fixing those things that you were complaining about in the early issue.
Whoa, lipstick's made of poison.
Yes.
Wow, that's pretty brutal.
And that's another thing from the books.
How did she not get poisoned by it? Or am I thinking this too?
Hand waving.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah, you're hand waving, whatever.
Thinking too much about it. Yeah, it's
very much an old action-adventure trope.
Yep.
The next issue is written by Mench and drawn by John Buscema. And I have a deep love of John Buscema. And inked by Frank Springer, who some people know more as a penciler. He did other penciling work. But again, your regular artist is not on this issue. And this is the confrontation. Between Shang-Chi and Fu Manchu. It's been building and building and building. And this is the one where he breaks into Fu Manchu's New York area. He once again fights the Council of Seven, which they point out are new people. And then he fights the, we find out that Fa Lu Sui has her own group of Saifan assassins. So there's a war going on between Fu Manchu and his daughter. They both have groups of Saifan assassins. And this is where Fu Manchu and Shang-Chi have their discussion. They talk out their differences. Shang-Chi has been out in the world. He knows more about the world. He has been very passive as he's learning all of this information. And we also get where Fu Manchu talks about how, in his mind, he's the hero. So they're layering the character even more, rather than he's just evil because he's evil and he does evil. We're finding out more about it. Here it is. How was the world bettered by forcing me to believe I had slain Dr. Petri. And Fu Manchu says, a test of your loyalty, Shang-Chi, a test you failed upon hearing the first words from Smith's twisted mouth. You see, I had hoped that you would aid me in attaining my goals. Instead, you have adopted different goals, and in so doing, you have erected between us a conflict of ideals. You think to me cruel and yourself gentle, that I am evil and you are good, that I am a villain to your sanctimonious hero. But who are you to judge me, to judge anyone as evil? Does it enhance the rising and advancing of your spirit? Or has your spirit risen to such heights that you now believe yourself to be God, capable of exercising celestial judgment on all those below you? There are many paths, Shang-Chi. Do not condemn me for following a path different from yours. They all lead inevitably to death, and all men are equally rewarded for their actions in life with the same death. Will your death be any better than mine? Before you answer, Shang-Chi, consider this. To me, you are evil. To me, you are the villain, and I am the hero.
Give that man the Eisner. Dust off the Kirby. So, give him the Kirbys. This was the most phenomenal confrontation. Because, you know, we're all thinking, oh, it's going to be a fight. No, it was a discussion. And it was a great discussion because, you know, you're thinking, this is always something we talk about. And later on, Marvel kind of covered it. Does Dr. Doom view himself as a villain? Does Magneto view himself as a villain? No, they don't. That's one of the beautiful things about Marvel is that the villains don't think they're villains. You know, they probably can't understand why the heroes are constantly thwarting them. And this is just a phenomenal confrontation, for lack of a better word. I'll just steal the title. And it continues and goes on because it says his sister still lives. And how do they want to deal with it? Fu Manchu says, unless you end it before it begins, you know, the war between the sister and himself, a war between two fierce factions of Saifan, between two global spanning armies, a war of bloodshed unrivaled since the ancient Tong Wars, a war between father and daughter, devil doctor and daughter of hell. Unless you end it before it begins, unless you end it now by killing me, my son. That's pretty heady stuff for a 70s code-approved book.
And then Shang-Chi's reaction is, I cannot make that decision. I only wish to slay evil and not you.
What a fundamental shift. He doesn't view his father as evil. At least not at this particular point. Going 27 issues and some giant size, believing his father was evil that just needed to be purged. And now he cannot make that decision. Yeah.
And at the end it says, a dynamic new direction for Shang-Chi in Death Deal. Well, you pick up the next issue, and it's written by Mensch, but drawn by three people.
If you bother to read the letter column, they talk about Shang-Chi's gunshot wound from the end of 23, and its miraculous recovery. And the editor explains that Fu Manchu gave him a serum, or it was a flesh wound, or whatever else you can imagine. So they do. I'm not the only one noticing this stuff, folks.
Well, and I also like the fact that they used to do that stuff in the letters pages the time. They would go, oh, yeah, here's the explanation. And if they didn't have one, if the reader sent in an explanation, they would get a no prize. In the 70s, that's how you got a no prize. Instead of saying, you made this mistake, it would be, you made this mistake, but it wasn't really a mistake because...
When somebody here also, the letter under that column also talks about, I could not imagine how, he's talking about Master Kung Fu number 24, the cluster that had four people drawing it. He goes, I could not imagine how this looked before Sal Trapani mangled the inks, but the issue looks as though it took 4 minutes to draw, 1 minute spent by each. That sentence was as badly put together as this comic. Also, please, I'm sick of the typical Nazi story. So, again, you know, they're not stepping away from our criticisms. They're all right there in the letter page, something that, you know, you almost have to go online to see anything like that nowadays.
The next issue, issue 28, drawn by three people, Ron Wilson, Ed Hannigan, and Aubrey Bradford, who's a name I do not remember ever seeing. Ed Hannigan actually went on in the 80s to do tons and tons of covers over at DC and at Marvel. He was very good at doing very interesting and innovative covers. He didn't do a lot of interiors, but the ones he did, he was okay at. Ron Wilson, who's probably best known for his run on Marvel 2-in-1. So we were promised a bold new direction. Well, yes, we're not
a small spirit slowly shaped. And it starts out in an acronym that we used to grow up in called a video arcade. Or they call it a penny arcade.
This is before the video arcades, because if you notice, there aren't any video games. This was before video games were big. It was skee ball and shooting games and pinball and stuff like that. And there's a part of me that wonders if this was a, oh, crap, Galassi isn't done yet, figure out some sort of fill-in you can do. Because this kind of continues the Fa Lu Sui story. And we get a much longer flashback with Fa Lu Sui, where Shang-Chi and his sister sit down and have a confrontation as well, where they discuss their issues, and they discuss the things between them. You also have the villain who had the mace on his head from Giant Size Number 3, although this time he's fighting with Shang-Chi, because they're fighting against Fa Lu Sui's men. So it's a...
It's not the Shadow Stalker, is it? Yes, Shadowstalker.
Yes. And so this is the, they are teaming up because they have a common enemy. It really reads like a fill-in. It's not a bad story. It fleshes out Fa Lu Sui's character more. It also gets rid of the rubies from the first part of the story. But to me, it really feels like a fill-in. It feels like, okay, how can we kind of tread water? Although... Remember, it starts in an arcade, and it ends with Shang-Chi talking about how these are games he doesn't understand. Later on in the series, one of the phrases he uses when he's upset with Nalen Smith is, "Your games of deceit and death." So this is probably where Mensch started to get the idea of games, how all of this feels like a game to those who are on a higher level, much like the chess game that we talked about earlier, that it's a chess game between Fu Manchu and Nalen Smith as they're moving pieces into place and having different schemes. So this is kind of where that started. It was a decent fill-in issue. It read well. And just because something's a fill-in doesn't mean it's good. It just means it just kind of stays in place. And again... Next issue, Paul Galassi returns, rejoins Doug Mensch for a dynamic new direction.
Woohoo!
And one of the things they do is something that I don't remember a Marvel book doing. They say, next issue is the start of a three-parter. The first part is going to be the Crystal Connection. The part after that will be Snowbuster. And the third part will be A Gulf of Lions. But before we get to that, we get Master of Kung Fu Giant Size Number
Woo-hoo!
4, which is drawn by Keith Pollard, inked by Sal Trapani, written by Doug Mensch, and has one of the great characters that Mensch has thrown
and
into
his
books. And
has never reappeared anywhere, as far as I can tell, which is a shame.
I think he showed up in a couple issues later.
Oh. Yeah,
Master
but he
Kung
should
Fu.
Be more widely used. He should be, this character should be like, the doorman of the Fantastic Four, the guy who wiggles his ears. Yes,
oh,
yes.
Willy
he
Lumpkin.
Should be like Willie Lumpkin. We're talking, of course, of the great, the criminally neglected and underused Rufus T. Hackstabber.
And those of you who know Marx Brothers movies kind of can figure by that name, this character is a pastiche of
Groucho
Marx.
You know, once you
Marx
get the hang of this, it kind of grows on
driver
you, like moss. And who knows what kind of moss we might attract if we weren't rolling so fast. That's a single panel. I love this issue just for this. I mean, it's utterly ridiculous character thrown in some ultra serious circumstances, and he just, I mean, it's crazy. And what does he want? What's his whole motivation for being in this entire issue? He wants a $7 and
he wants that $7
that the robber stuff for him. Yep.
Well, he gave him a cab ride.
Yeah,
and didn't pay
that's,
for it.
Oh, that's way too much for Mr. Hackstabber.
And it's an action-adventure story, but it's very fun in that there are a lot of lighter moments in it. Like page 469, where the bank robbers knock over an old lady who was crossing the street, who then attacks Rufus T. Hackstabber and won't let him chase them because she's been so offended by being knocked over. Of course, there's a appearance by Fu Manchu, who's behind the bank robberies, of course, because everything has to do with him.
And the other thing about this issue, it's more that Shang-Chi is being forced along, you know, because one of the reasons he gets in the cab with, I can't even say his name, Hackstabber, is because as Hackstabber's getting ready to drive away and go after the robbers, the cops show up, and of course, in typical cop comic fashion, they go after the guy in the weird suit. So they start shooting at Shang-Chi, and he's like, bam, 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 have no choice. And of course, after the battle axe we talked about that stopped the chase, he's like, the delay has been much like the rest of this day. And this day has been most strange.
And another story where Shang-Chi is not the one driving the story. He's brought along for the ride. He is not, in a lot of ways, he's not the protagonist. He's just along. Which, again, I want to point out, this is very different from Marvel's normal storytelling style. And I think part of it is, when you think about where Minch came from, this was his first series. And I don't know if we talked a lot about where Minch came from with comics. He was born in Chicago, and he broke into comics by sending stories to Warren magazines. He sent a story to Warren. He actually sent five stories to Warren. They bought all five of them. So, and the check he got was for $125. He thought the check for $125 was for one of the stories. Nope, it was for all of them. He got 25 bucks a story. So he's like, oh, crap, if I'm going to make a living out of this, I got to write a lot more. So he sent tons of stories to Warren, and Jim Warren wouldn't buy all of them, so he would take the rejects and sell them to Skywald, which was another black-and-white magazine horror comic publisher, and he'd send some to Marvel, and when Warren found out about this, it's like, you're a traitor, you're working for these other companies, and Mensch was like, well, you're not buying everything that I send you, and they had a huge fight, and Mensch said, fuck you, I quit. And then a couple weeks later, Mensch got this huge box from Warren's Captain Company full of masks and, you know, just merch. It was just full of merch. And it was Warren saying, look, I'm sorry, please don't quit, keep writing. Eventually, Mensch moved to New York, got a job at Marvel. He was doing what most writers did. He started in the assistant editor, which was proofreading. And was given this series. It sold well, so he was given Werewolf by Night and on and on and on. But he didn't come from writing regular superhero comics. He came from writing horror books. And in horror books, it's all plot, especially when it's those 8 and 12 page stories. It's all plot. There's no characterization. It's all plot. And in a horror story, the character reacts. They don't act. And I think that's why in these stories, Shang-Chi reacts. He doesn't act, at least not till later. But so far, all of the giant-sized stories have been good, except for the art in the
And, of course, I don't want people worried, although you really should run out and get the Omnibus or a giant-sized number 4. But, you know, Mr. Hackstabber did finally get his $7.80.
And we get a very rare
yes,
smile from
Shang-Chi. Yes, which
is
almost as frightening as anything else we've seen.
But all in all, this was a fun issue. It showed Mensch's love for the Marx Brothers. And while he wasn't as good as Lord Julius, I like
him. I do. Now, there's a team-up we need to see. Again, if I was writing Marvel Comics, these are the characters that I would bring back. I mean, they might have parody problems, but I don't know.
I think you can use a character once as parody, but if you use them more and more, you get in trouble for it. But then again, you know, again, Cerebus, he used Lord Julius constantly and never got into any trouble. So I don't see where it would be that big a deal. The last issue that we'll be covering is issue 29, and it is The New Direction. It is also the first of a three-part story. It is called The Crystal Connection. It's written by Mensch, and Galassi is artist. That means he inked his own pencils in this stuff. And as such, you see the art take a huge leap forward. Really, really amazing art in this issue. Beautiful use of light and shadow. Just leaps above. And as you look at it, you can see why it took the extra time. Because if Galassi's inking his own stuff, it's going to look better. The other thing that I want to point out about this, it also doesn't start the way the other issues have, where the characters are giving the setup. You know, on the first page, they're giving the setup in most stories. This one, nope, it's very symbolic. And Joe, when you look at that, first page, 501. If that were a movie poster, what kind of movie do you think it would be?
Well, it looks almost like a Bruce Lee movie.
To me, when I see it, okay, you've got the map in the background, you have the broken flowers, you've got this stuff. To me, it looks like a James Bond movie.
It certainly reads like that.
And yes, Shang-Chi looks more like Bruce Lee than he ever has. But this is very much what Mensch did. He decided he was no longer going to use the martial arts movie tropes. By this time, we're talking this was about
75, 76. Yeah, we're talking this issue has a date of June 75. So we're midsummer.
Well, if it was June 75, that means it came out in the spring. Because the dates were about 3 months ahead. So we're talking 75. By now, the martial arts craze is fading pretty fast. So I can see not wanting to be keyed in with that and using those tropes, but also Mensch was a huge Bond fan. One of the things he did when he was at Eclipse, he did a Bond story. Same with Don McGregor. Don McGregor, huge Bond fan, he did a Bond story. But he moves Master of Kung Fu out of the Kung Fu realm and into more of the espionage realm with this issue. So the whole brand new direction, it wasn't just what Marvel did every so often when, oh, sales are down, tell people it's a new direction. Mensch really gave the series a change, gave it a shift. And in a lot of ways, this is the story that brought it to a higher level among comics fans. So it uses a lot of Clive Ruston. But as you look at this art, Black Jack Tar, completely different looking character now. We deal with the fact that Shang-Chi is conflicted at this point. He no longer knows where the lines
are. And this is the first time neither Fu Manchu nor any of the minions appear in a Master of Kung Fu story. It's kind of understood, at least I understood, that the war between Fu Manchu and his daughter, while it may be raging, Shang-Chi is no longer part of it.
Right. We also get kind of, in a lot of ways, the first villain that has been used elsewhere with Razor Fist. Most of the villains in Master of Kung Fu just showed up in Master of Kung Fu, but Razor Fist actually has shown up in
including
other Marvel comics.
Avengers versus JLA. Now, issue 4, go look
yes.
for him.
But this is also, the villain has his island fortress, just like a Bond villain.
Clive Reston is in it, our good buddy who's, you know, son of James Bond, grandson of Sherlock Holmes. Well, we can't mention that now.
Sherlock Holmes is his
nephew, niece. I don't know.
But this is very much the Bond thing of impenetrable fortress.
Ooh, kinky.
To the point where one of the things in the Bond movies, because Ian Fleming loves scuba diving so much, in the Bond books, there always seems to be a sequence where Bond is scuba diving. There's scuba diving in this issue. So he's using the Bond tropes here rather than the Kung Fu tropes. And I, every time I look at this, the art just is such a leap forward for Galassi. It's just beautiful. And if you want to see the Bruce Lee stuff, go to page 516.
Woohoo! Oof.
You know, you've got a lot of the photo reference here, but he really... So the panels showing the fight, the second panel at the top, beautiful use of light and shadow there. Just amazing with the kung fu pose. And then the final panel at the bottom. I can't imagine how that would have reproduced on the crap paper that Marvel was using, but on this paper where they're using, where they've got the film, they're putting it in the best possible light. This is amazing stuff. This is just amazing art. Beautifully drawn, beautifully designed. And it's the first of a three-part story. And we're actually going to be ending on a cliffhanger. But this is the big shift. There's also a lot of the main villain pontificating and talking like a Bond villain, explaining his plan. But also, he's not... he's not a Fu Manchu minion. He has no connection to him. This is MI6 is now sending Shang-Chi out for spy missions. So, huge shift in the story.
Almost jarring from the previous issues. Because, I mean, yeah. You're used to just the kung fu aspect being there. And I got to admit, I don't know if I necessarily liked the shift. I had to go back and look to make sure Doug Minch was still writing it. Maybe in rereading, I actually got to appreciate a little bit more. I don't know how it did sales-wise. I mean, I guess we'll find out as we get into the next part of us reviewing the issues. And, you know, we're talking the series, you know, ends up going, what was the last issue? So it'll go for some time. But I don't know how long this will last or if this just continues. Is this because they lost the rights or they didn't want to pay the rights to keep using?
No, they still had the rights, but Mensch hasn't talked about it a lot. But I think what it is, it's if you're going up against Fu Manchu every issue, over and over and over again, there's a repetitiveness to it. And it could also be with the kung fu craze starting to die out, maybe the sales started to dip a little bit. I don't know. But this is kind of where the book took a huge step in quality. And when you read the reviews of it, people talk about this is where it shifted into a higher gear. This is when it started doing better, artistically. So Fu Manchu doesn't go away. He is back later, but we're going to get some stories without him for now. And that's where we're going to wrap up. We're going to be doing the next 10 issues in a little while. Joe, as you read these 10 issues, what was your overall impression?
For the most part, I enjoyed them. I guess I'm not, we talked about the art differences. But I found them pretty compelling. This last issue we reviewed, for me, was jarring because of the change. But rereading it, I guess it actually works out pretty good. And I could see where maybe people might have dropped off. I'll have to go forward and look into the letters column for the next show to see, did people complain? Did people like it? Obviously, to a certain point, they must have because the book continues on, well well into 1983, and we're only, what the hell are we? We're on like 1976 right now. So for me, it was fun because, as I mentioned in the first podcast we did, this is the first time I've read these. And to read them in the Omni format was just fantastic and a lot of fun.
Well, I want to thank you for coming on.
And there it is, Master of Kung Fu, Episode 2. Series in review, like all the other podcasts here at the Solitaire Rose Radio Network. I don't know, do I want to call it the Solitaire Rose Network, Solitaire Rose Radio Network? I haven't decided yet, and I haven't set up the main webpage yet, so I have time. But anyway, they've all got one thing in common, and that is ads. And here are these. That's right, here at the Solitaire Rose Radio Network, we have ads, and our first sponsor is me. That's right, your charming and delightful old Uncle Rap Bastard. I have my first book out with Dangerous Dan Moore. It's the first 100 strips of our online web strip, Worldwide News, the story of the lowest-rated cable news network. And you can get yourself a copy with commentary, with all sorts of extras, with signatures and everything. Just email Dan over at lordshadowflame@gmail.com. Our top sponsor, who's been with us since day one, is DreamHost. DreamHost.com. You need yourself a website, and DreamHost.com is the number one web host in the whole known universe. Just head over to DreamHost.com, put in the code KRAYZ, K-R-A-Y-Z, get $20 off your first year. How can you beat that? Our other sponsor is Graze, G-R-A-Z-E.com. Healthy snacks for a healthy lifestyle. Just head over to Kray Z, put in the code CORYS3R5P. Your first and fifth box are free. You can get them weekly. You can get them bi-weekly. You can get them monthly. You just order a whole bunch of them. It's great stuff to keep you away from the vending machine at work. Now, if you would like to leave a comment for any of the podcasts that we do, we'd love those. Go ahead and email us at solitairerosenetwork@gmail.com, or you can call 952-856-0519. Operators are standing by. Okay, it's just a place that we'll record your calls, but we'll play them on the air. We'll answer your questions. We love getting feedback. Tell us what you think. Ask a question. Suggest a topic. Be a guest. Send us your stuff. solitairerosenetwork@gmail.com. If you would like to advertise on any of the Solitaire Rose radio shows, you can. Just email us at solitairerosenetwork@gmail.com, subject advertising. Thanks. I want to thank you for listening. Please tune in to the other podcasts I do. I'm keeping this on the Kray Z Comics and Stories feed because it's comic related. We've got Kray Z Comics and Stories, which no matter what, come rain or shine, come blizzard or tornado, drops every Monday morning. Then there's Solitaire Rose Radio, which is interviews and essays and stories and other things, whatever's floating around in my brain. We've also got Bad Advice with Wolfie and Cory, which second episode will be coming very, very soon. And Novelcast Radio, which is Solitaire Rose Novelcast, which is at novels.solitairerose.com. For Bad Advice, it's badadvice.solitairerose.com. The weekly news update will be coming back once I get a little time carved out of my schedule. Joe and I will be back with the next 10 issues of Master of Kung Fu as the series moves from kind of a martial arts series to an espionage series over the next batch of issues. I want to thank you for listening. I am looking for your feedback. If there is a series you would like Solitaire Rose Radio to do a series and review of, go ahead and email me at solitairerosenetwork@gmail.com. You can also buy advertising, as I talked about in the ads. And remember that book that Dan and I put out. Please go ahead and buy a copy. We'll be back soon with another episode of Series in Review.